morning. I'm Chris Clark. I'm going to talk to you today about the LSU AgCenter virus-tested sweet potato program, and in particular the therapy part and the tissue culture part that we do here in the Baton Rouge campus in the Department of Plant Pathology and Crop Physiology. So this all starts with breeding lines that we get from Dr. Don Labonte, who is our breeder. He evaluates his breeding lines in the field for 3 or 4 or 5 years. And the viruses that infect sweet potato reinfect these very, very quickly. So they start as little seedlings that are healthy, but once they've been in the field for 1 year, we can usually assume that they're going to be infected with viruses. And here is an example of a plant from his breeding program. This has been in the field for 6 years now, and you can see some of the symptoms, the purpling along the veins, are symptoms of some of the common viruses that occur here in Louisiana. And they can, despite the fact that they produce relatively mild symptoms, they can reduce yield up to anywhere from 25% to 40%. So this is a relatively big deal for a relatively subtle disease for sweet potato growers. So back in 1999, we began the virus-tested aspects of the Sweet Potato Foundation seed program, and we have been gradually evolving and changing things ever since. And then in 2015, we, along with 5 other states, joined the National Clean Plant Network for sweet potato. And now we have a collaborative arrangement with those states where we share germplasm, we share methods, we share information, and we try to develop the best possible clean plants for our country. That involves assuring our stakeholders that what we're doing is the best possible process. So one of the things we've started this year is developing a quality management system. So as you'll see as we walk through this program, there are a lot of technical aspects to it. It's very hard for the stakeholders to really understand what those are all about. So I'm going to walk you through the process from start to finish, and at the end I'll sort of summarize how the quality management system affects this. We start with this breeding line infected with viruses, and the first thing we have to do is try to generate a plant that's free of viruses. The viruses, unfortunately, spread almost throughout the entire plant with one tiny exception. They don't move into the tip of the meristem at the very end of the vine. So the first thing we do is to take a vine like this and we subject it to meristem tip culture. And you can see on the slide the process we go through, where we take a vine, cut all the leaves off, and then we come down to something like this. We have a shoot tip, remove all the leaves, remove the tiny little leaves that haven't really developed yet, and we cut the very tip meristem, a piece maybe only 0.5 millimeter in length, that we then put in media and try to regenerate a plant using that. We do this because the virus moves up to about 1 millimeter from the tip. So if we cut 0.5 millimeter piece, we hope we get a plant that is free of viruses. But as part of the quality management system, what we have to do is say what we're going to do, do what we say we're going to do, prove it, and improve on it. And this is what I'm going to focus on as we walk through the rest of the program. So cutting the meristems requires a special art and technique as well as knowledge, and very few people can do it really well. We're fortunate we have somebody by the name of Cathy DeRobertis who does an excellent job of that. And she puts those meristems that are about the size of a flake of pepper on special media, and these have been growing for about 6 weeks now since those meristems were cut. So you can see how small they are. It takes about 2 to 3 months for one of those meristems, if we're fortunate, to regenerate something that looks like a plant. So Kathy will show you some of the plants that she has regenerated from these meristems.
All right, this rack is representative of one breeding line. The breeding line here is 17162, and for each meristem cut, they're given a separate number. And then this is one particular meristem, and it's divided into two after it starts growing. One tube stays here in the tissue culture room so that it can be saved and cut over and over and kept here in our library of tissue cultures. And the other one is going to go to the greenhouse. This one's going to be potted in the greenhouse, and there all kind of testing is going to take place, from grafting onto the setosa to actually taking parts of this particular plant and looking for the viruses by extracting nucleic acids. So all of these racks are representative of what we've done in 1 year. So each rack represents a different line. And all of the meristems and all of the ones that are getting ready to go to the greenhouse to be tested.
So as Kathy has just mentioned, we regenerate plants, we keep one in tissue culture essentially in perpetuity, so that whenever anyone wants it, we can go back to the tissue culture. At the same time, we take a plant derived from that and take it to the greenhouse. And here you can see one that has been taken to the greenhouse just a short while ago, about 2 weeks ago. It's starting to grow out and look like a normal sweet potato plant now. That has been through the meristem tip culture, but we really don't know whether we were lucky and got a plant that did not have viruses or whether perhaps it still does have a virus. So the next phase is virus testing. Every one of those meristems has to be tested separately. And this starts by going to the greenhouse and grafting the sweet potato onto a Brazilian morning glory plant. So these are grown from seed, which exclude viruses, so we know that we have a plant that is without viruses to begin with, and this particular morning glory shows symptoms whenever it's infected with most sweet potato viruses. So we can begin to look at those and see either hopefully a healthy plant, as you see on the left in this slide, or plants that have symptoms of different viruses that occur in sweet potatoes. And we know that those then have to be discarded. So the idea is to find one that does not produce any symptoms in the Brazilian morning glory. We do that 3 times in a row, just to be redundant, to be sure we don't miss anything. Then we also do molecular testing, and we'll show you a little bit about that in our main lab. So once we've started the virus testing process by grafting in the greenhouse, we also do other tests that include molecular tests like PCR, polymerase chain reaction tests. That means we have to take leaves from the morning glory and separately leaves from the sweet potato. We grind them up using this homogenizer, extract the DNA from them, and then in a special chamber we set up PCR tests that amplify whatever target virus nucleic acid is in there. So this test is for a specific virus. We have one that is for the podi viruses, we have another one that is for sweet potato leaf curl virus, and another one for sweet potato chlorotic stunt virus. This has to be done in a protected chamber because the amplification is so strong that if any contamination gets in, it can foul up our results. So from here, we go and do a PCR test using equipment that cycles the temperature. So we take our nucleic acid extracts, put them in a plate like this. We add all sorts of chemical reagents, enzymes, and we put them in a machine called a thermal cycler that goes through a cycle of 3 different temperatures to replicate the nucleic acid 40 different times. So if you start out with a very small amount of nucleic acid, you end up with several million fold more copies of that nucleic acid. By amplifying it that way, then it allows us to run it on an electrophoresis gel where we can actually visualize the little pieces of nucleic acid, and we can then see if that nucleic acid is present. We know the virus was present, If we don't detect it, then we assume that it wasn't. So in the end, we end up with a gel that looks something like what you see on the right side of this picture here. You can see the process on the left, and we have a gel that has different light bands in it. And those are at different positions in the gel that indicate the size of the piece that was produced. And they're characteristic for different viruses. So where you see in the top gel, at the bottom is a band that should be present in every sweet potato plant. That's sort of our internal standard to make sure that everything worked. Above that are different bands that represent different viruses. So this gives us confirmation that the plant either has or does not have specific viruses. So this whole virus testing system has evolved. When we started in 1999, we were relying almost exclusively on grafting tip amyacetosa, the Brazilian morning glory. As time has gone on, more and more of these molecular assays have become available, which also require more and more equipment because each one requires a different specialized piece of equipment. But this has really improved our ability to assure our customers that what we're producing is truly free of viruses to the best of our ability. So once these different miraclones, as we call them, have been all the way through the virus testing process and we've decided that they are truly free of viruses, the original tissue culture is maintained. But this is sort of like taxes. Every year we have another 10 or 12 new breeding lines that we add to our collection, and we have roughly 200 different genotypes of sweet potato right now that we're maintaining as virus-tested tissue cultures. That means that every 2 or 3 months, somebody has to come in, make new media, make transfers, and do it all very carefully to make sure that they don't get contaminated with bacteria or fungi. So these are just maintenance. This is us treading water, essentially, staying still. The next step in the process is then to micropropagate these so that they can go up to the sweet potato research station in Chase. And Kathy will explain to you the micropropagation process.
So at a certain point, the different growers put in their request for the kind of sweet potato that they like. Sometimes they want a purple variety, sometimes they want a sweeter one, one that's more resistant. So we get the orders from our research station, and then our job is to begin propagating them and multiplying them more and more and more so that at a certain point we send them to the research station where they bring them to the greenhouses and multiply them further. So we take the tissue culture plants that come in the regular maintenance tube, and each time we cut it and divide each tube probably into 4 or 5 little plants, and in each one of these boxes we add 4 or 5 little plants. We let the boxes grow somewhere between 4 to 8 weeks, and then we divide them again, and the process goes on and on and on until we get the thousands of plants that we need to send to the people that need them for growing.
So as you can see from what we've shown you so far, this is a process that has many steps, each one of which is pretty complicated, and it's a constantly evolving process, as I mentioned before. So Kathy just mentioned how we micropropagate sweet potatoes in tissue culture now. That's a very time-consuming, laborious, expensive thing to do. So we've recently learned about some other programs that work with yam and cassava that do a sort of hydroponics propagation process in the lab. And we're going to be doing research to make our process more efficient and time-effective. Other things that happen along the way is we have a process to detect all the viruses we know about in sweet potato, but sweet potato has not had anywhere near as much research effort on it as, say, the Irish potato has. So we always keep an open mind. Maybe there's something else out there we haven't seen before. And this year, one of the nice things about our process of using the Brazilian morning glory to graft to is that it allows us to detect viruses that maybe our molecular methods don't detect. And so this year we have found one that fits that bill. We've not seen it before, but we've always had the suspicion that maybe there are other viruses we didn't know about. So now this is the start of a new research project. What is this virus? What effect does it have on sweet potatoes? So the process is constantly evolving, but we've been fortunate that the National Clean Plant Network has helped to invest a lot of money in the equipment that's necessary to do this type of work. And one of the things they're interested in is making sure that our stakeholders feel satisfied that what we're doing is the best possible job. So as I mentioned earlier, this year we started a quality management system program to try to document everything we do. And we have started the system. One of the very few nice things about the COVID-19 lockdown is it's given us a lot of time to work at the computer. And in the process, we've developed a lot of documents towards this quality management system. So things like quality procedures that outline why we do the types of things, what our goals are, what are the criteria, work instructions, so that anybody who does one of the virus tests can do it exactly the same way as any other person does it. And then a record-keeping system so that everything that is done is recorded and we can find our way back to it in case there are ever any questions. So we've come a long way since 1999. We're very grateful for the cooperation of the National Clean Plant Network and our LSU AgCenter Sweet Potato Foundation program. We think we've improved the quality greatly, and we're working on improving the efficiency and the availability of plants.